abdominal pain, basophilic stippling, closing the eyes, you can answer it as lead poisoning. Okay. So what is this basophilic stipples, doctor? They are the typical round dark blue granules that you can find only by doing the supravital staining. Typically lead poisoning, anemias and septicemias, you can come across them. But what are those stipples contain, doctor? They basically contain ribosomes in mitochondria is what need to be basically remembered. I think recently DNB exam, their pearl stain is used where? What is your answer, doctor? Iron. Good, good. So let's go to the next question. Sigmoidoscopy showing flash-shaped ulcer means what is that? Amebiasis. What is the treatment, doctor? Metronidazole is considered a treatment of choice. So you can't forget about this cysts of the amebiasis, and if you do the endoscopy, you can see the presence of this colonic flash-shaped ulceration is what I want to underscore to all of you. Let's go to the next question. Patient is having high-grade fever and he is having conjunctival hemorrhage with the hyperbilirubinemia and peripheral smear is MP negative, then what is the possibility, doctor? Favorite question and favorite clinical scenario that you come across in your clinical practice. Leptospirosis caused by leptospira icterohemorrhagica should never be forgotten. It is the rat's urine which is the one which is implicated. It is the typical leptospira. A farmer with the history of walking in the fields in a barefoot comes with the history of the very high fever, renal dysfunction with the jaundice. You have thought it is possibly malaria in this part of the world, but it, MP is negative. Leptospira also will be negative. That is a sad story. Because by 9th or 10th day, sometimes lepto can become positive, though it is negative on the first day. That also can happen in leptospirosis. So what you will do generally in this clinical scenario, in our context, on one side you will be sending crystalline penicillin to take care of leptospira, other side you will also start the anti-malarial. Because you need to have more generalized diagnosis, right? But not beyond it. But unfortunately, if you also start ciprofloxacin, thinking it enteric fever, starting thinking it as meningitis, starting the ceftriaxone, there the patient will land in more difficulty. Okay, let's go to the next question. Patient is having high SGOT, high SGPT, the history of decreased appetite. One of the classical histories, doctor. You can remember in the childhood when the classical physician who examined you, oh, decreased appetite is there, probably hepatitis is there, is the classical thing. Appetite is improving, gastroenterologist will have a smile in his face. Oh, this fellow's liver is improving. So there's a reason you can't forget, doctor. ALT, in fact, can sometimes rise several thousand units in the patients who are having the acute viral hepatitis is what I want to underscore to all of you. Now let's go to the next question. 70-year-old male presented to the emergency with a pain in the epigastrium with breathing for 6 hours and 56 is the pulse rate and the blood pressure has come down. Chest examination was normal. But the patient was receiving GE reflux omeprazole, then what is the next investigation you want to do? I still remember one eminent member of parliament who admitted under our care. He has eaten sitafal and developed chest pain. So one of the house surgeons writing was sitafal associated angina. So SA is the the diagnosis. Even the MP was so convinced that, hey, doctor, you are unnecessarily making the diagnosis of angina. Your junior house surgeon, so nice, sitafal associated angina, she made, no, it is not angina. Denial is one of the common causes, doctor, for the mortality in the myocardial infarction. Even a professor of medicine who treated so many angina cases finally dies thinking that that chest pain is not the angina and taking one omeprazole and finally landing in a severe arrhythmia which has succumbed him, popped him out of the medicine unit. His junior professor become the HOD. You know? So that's the reason, doctor, ECG, because the typical right coronary artery occlusion leads to development of the AV nodal blocks with the development of a severe right ventricular failure with the development of hypotension, and all these problems will be appearing. Let's go to the next question. HbSAg was positive but HbeAg is negative. HbSAg is a sign of proliferation. Then if such a woman is pregnant, then what is the appropriate therapy for the baby? So this important protocol should not be forgotten as obstetricians and general physicians, doctor. Infants born to any HbSAg positive mother, irrespective of her HbeAg status, need to receive the HbIg immunoglobulin. In addition to that, the first dose of hepatitis B need to be given within 12 hours of the birth, followed by the second and third doses at 1 and 6 months of the age, respectively, is what you need to basically remember. And If HPIAG and the initial dose of the vaccine is delayed for greater than 1 month, then what do you want to do? That's the next important question. Let us say she is born in a small village where you don't have that obstetrician knowing all these things. And she came to the city, to the in-laws place, and there they found that it was not given. Mother is HPSAG positive. What to do? This is a precious child. Vamshankur is what they will say. Then what is your protocol? If it is not given at birth and 1 month later the baby has come. Then you need to test for HPSAG and determine if the infant is already infected is the next important part of the protocol. Let's go to the next question. The blood culture in a patient who has got Pseudomonas positivity and which is beta-lactamase producer, then what is the best antibiotic of choice? It's a one challenging question and an interesting question which is helpful, doctor. Estrionam monobactam is basically inhibitor of the cell wall synthesis during the bacterial growth. You have a lot of protocols available. Of all these, cepticidine plus amikacin can consider be best in case of the organism is producing extended spectrum beta-lactamase enzyme is what need to be remembered. Of course, this requires more longer discussion. What are beta-lactam antibiotics and all that big story is there. Let's go to the next question. A known HIV patient is admitted for abdominal surgery following an accident. And dressing is soaked in blood. And what is the next method of, best method to dispose it, doctor? First, put 1% hypochlorite on the dressing material. Send for incineration in appropriate bag, closed bag is very important. Okay? So, this another common clinical scenario. Okay. Let's go to the next question. 45-year-old has come with abdominal pain and vaginal discharge. On examination, cervicitis is there, but no bacteria. Then what is the organism? Chlamydia. So McCoy cells, chlamydia typically leads to a silent disease. In 3/4 of infected women, there are no symptoms is what need to be remembered. And okay, what are the other options that are available here? Chocolate agar supplemented with hemin. It is meant for which organism, doctor? H influenza strains will be growing on the chocolate agar, which is supplied by the hemin, and NAD is a favorite question of the examiner. Now, what is the other option available? The Vero cell culture and the bilayer human blood agar culture. What are they meant for? Gardnerella and the other anaerobes will be grown on the brain heart infusion blood agar or human blood bilayer medium, otherwise called HBT medium, is the one which is typically used for the Gardnerella, is what need to be remembered, doctor. Then what is this Vero cell culture meant for? Typically it is the Yashomura who is the one who discovered it. Vero cells basically are used for identifying the Vero toxins which are produced by the E. coli's strains, doctor. And typically the virus, if it is there really, or a toxin is there, it will produce some cytolytic changes in this Vero cell culture which is basically used, is what need to be remembered. Let's go to the next question. A favorite question. Alpha hemolytic colonies typically will show, how do you differentiate the different alpha hemolysis? Already I think in one of our Sunday test discussions we discussed what is alpha and beta hemolysis, what is bile solubility and bile resistance. Anyway, we shall once more discuss. Please remember, alpha hemolytic cocci typically have got a very low degree of pathogenicity compared to that of the pneumococci, which are also basically alpha hemolytic in nature. Unlike the pneumococci, the Streptococcus viridans is neither bile soluble nor sensitive to the optogen. Whereas the Streptococcus pneumoniae, unlike the Streptococcus viridans, will be bile soluble, and also it is optogen sensitive is what need to be basically remembered. Why do you need to remember Streptococcus viridans, doctor? It is the cause for SAEB, subacute macular endocarditis. So please remember, pneumococci are those classical diplococci, if you do in a lobar pneumonia patient, the gram stain of the sputum. And Streptococcus pneumoniae typically will be gram positive. And Streptococcus pneumoniae, if you try to grow it, typically around that optogen which is impregnated here, there will be no growth is what need to be remembered. There is a capsular swelling which is called the Quellen's reaction with the Streptococcus pneumoniae. Basically, they are a pair of the diplococci, and their capsular material can also be fluorescent antibody stained is what need to be remembered. So let's go to the next question. What is the buzzword? Bile solubility, optogen sensitivity. They are the two things that you are going to remember. Listeriosis, another favorite question. What is the mechanism of action? Why your cell wall synthesis inhibitor antibiotics are not helpful in managing the Listeriosis is my question to all of you. So please remember, doctor, Listeria is basically a gram-positive rod-shaped bacterium which is caused by eating the food contaminated with the bacteria is what need to be remembered. Now what is the peculiarity of its way of life cycle? Very, very important. Typically, it is taken up by the non-phagocytic cells, and it is basically one important membrane-associated protein called internalin, which is responsible for it to be taken up. Once it is ingested, this typical bacterium will produce listeriolysin, and generally once the organism is taken, the lysosomes will attack it and it will be taken up by the phagosome. But its ability to produce this listeriolysin will make it to escape from the phagosome, and within the cytoplasm only, happily it will be multiplying continuously, and it will be moving through the cytoplasm to invade the adjacent cells by polymerizing them, is what need to be basically remembered. So if you look at the growth and the viability of the listeria in certain folds, especially at the freezing temperature versus that of the refrigeration temperature, over a 12-week period, typically at the level of the refrigeration temperature of 4 degrees Celsius is very favorite temperature for the listeria to grow. So refrigerated, frozen foods are the ones which are the risk factors, is what need to be remembered. Let's go to the next question. HIV patient, gram stain of lung aspirate shows yeast-like organism. So what are all the list of yeast-like fungi which are not the yeast-like fungi? Let us be very sure about. Aspergillus fumigatus is not yeast-like. Already you have seen this. Now Cryptococcus neoformis is an encapsulated Blastomycete, which is typically yeast-like in nature. Cryptococcosis can cause meningitis. India ink preparation should not be forgotten. Penicillium marfini will be typically causing, it is a dimorphic fungus which can be yeast-like and mold-like, and it is endemic in the patients who are having HIV infection. It can lead to the development of a disseminated infection on the leg of this HIV patient, you can clearly see. And Penicillium marfini is basically a yeast-like form, and it will be reproducing by fission, is what need to be remembered. So what is the answer? Aspergillus fumigatus. Let's go to the next question. Acute lymphocytic leukemia, the patient is having neutropenia and developed diarrhea after amoxicillin. What is your answer? It is the pseudomembranous colitis caused by the Clostridium difficile, which can be identified by doing the endoscopy, is what need to be remembered. Mycoplasma is typically what type of organism, doctor? Is it intracellular organism like Listeria, which you have classically identified? It is not an obligate intracellular organism. Typically, mycoplasma will be growing on the agar to form this kind of fried egg appearance of the mycoplasma. So, fried egg appearance should not be forgotten. Mycoplasmas are basically the surface parasites which will be homing on the human respiratory and urogenital tract. Basically, how they can do that? How can they adhere to the cells? Basically, they can attach to the xyloglycoproteins which are there on the tracheal epithelium. That's how it can be able to attach to the epithelium, is what need to be remembered. Because they are not intracellular in their location, they are not generally vulnerable with the regular antibiotics. Erythromycin and tetracycline is the treatment of choice, which is a favorite question. Let's go to the next question. Woman is having BRCA1 CA2 mutations, then how do you want to check whether she is developing the ovarian cancer? BRCA1 CA2, why they are important, doctor? They are helpful in the breast cancer screening. They are also used for other genitourinary cancer screening also. What is your favorite possible answer? One possible answer. You are the treating obstetrician or epidemiologist. What do you want to use? What do you want to say if a woman comes to you after reading in the internet, in the newspaper, that BRCA1 is very important? Incidentally, one of her second cousin is also, who is working in Intel Pentium, is having breast cancer recently detected. What do you want to do? So please remember, screening with the transvaginal ultrasound is considered to be the most important part of the protocol. Regularly, she need to receive the screening with the transvaginal ultrasound, is what I want to underscore to all of you. Let's go to the next question. Cornea typically is having different layers, all of you know. From outer to inner epithelium, basement membrane, Bowman's membrane, substantia propria, decimates membrane, endothelium, these five important layers should not be forgotten. It is this endothelial cell morphology which can be identified by the specular microscope, which is responsible for maintaining the transparency, is what need to be basically remembered. Now let's go to the next question. Bicornuate uterus typically is used for what purpose? I mean, when do you want to do the surgery, is a very important question. Two things are there, doctor. Unlike unicornuate uterus, bicornuate uterus does not lead to the development of infertility. Fertility very much is possible, but there is no space. It is like a hostel room shared by 2-3 people, is the kind of situation in that bicornuate uterus. Hence, there is a chance of habitual abortions to occur. So that is the reason, doctor, if you look at the structure of the bicornuate uterus, typically there is a central depression at the top of this uterine cavity. And it is not due to the abnormal it is not due to the abnormal presence of any poorly vascularized tissue. The situation which you see in the case of the septate uterus. It is, that is the reason this particular tissue is very well vascularized in spite of having this depression leading to the bicornate shape. Hence, if fallopian tube fertilization happened, it can wonderfully can get implanted. Whereas septate uterus, it can't implant. Whereas bicornate uterus, it can implant. But it can lead to habitual abortions. If that is the story, then repair the uterus and once more let the woman become the mother, which is the ultimate thing need to be remembered. You have done the bloody tap of the amniocentesis, which is not affected, doctor. Phosphatidyl glycerol is the one which can still help you. Even the, what you call, bilirubin OD measurement also will become fallacious. Let's go to the next question. Whether it is pregnant or non-pregnant, which is the best indicator of iron deficiency very early? Ferritin is considered to be the indicator, is the golden rule that should not be forgotten. When do we switch over from fetal to the adult hemoglobin, doctor? Yes? Previous question?
Yes, sir.
You like to put transferrin as the answer?
No, 74,
yeah.
There are 36 weeks.
36 weeks, eh? How many are sure? 30 and 36. We see a lot of 32 weeks babies also, no? I mean, we see a good number of 30 to 34 week babies. If 36 weeks would have been the switchover time, then more number of hemoglobinopathy having children we would have seen at 30 to 34 week. No? But such? Harrison is 30. Yeah? Good. I mean, 30, 32, you need to be doubly sure. You can kindly check it and just let me know. Hmm? So, I'm very happy. Some kind of 0 hour session also we'll have. Because the thing is that of it is not always omni true, doctor. Probably another difference will say another value, especially when it comes to values. Achach. Okay, okay. Since last year AIMS, this year AIMS, it did not change much. So let us go to the next question. Alpha fetoprotein will be highest in the case of gastroschisis and also omphalocele, but I did not find any reference in which case exact values are calculated, in which it is much higher. If you have any reference, you can just let me know.
Achha.
Then compared to that other conditions. So there is a reason you can just give me a reference. These questions I could not get even a reference. But what is the most common cause for the maternal serum alpha-fetoprotein to become elevated, doctor? It is a wrong estimation of the gestational age of the fetus is the most common cause is what need to be basically remembered. Let's go to the next question. Enteric fever in the pregnancy, what is the treatment of choice? Undoubtedly, ceftriaxone is considered to be the treatment of choice, parenteral ceftriaxone. Which is the commonest tumor of the thyroid, doctor? Papillary carcinoma of the thyroid is very, very common. Third to fifth decade is the time where it will be peaking. So this is the typical appearance of the papillary folding of the papillary carcinoma of the thyroid. Anaplastic carcinoma of the thyroid is infiltrating into the trachea and sternum. Then in that case, what do you want to do? I like to ask you a question. If it were not to be anaplastic, if it were to be papillary carcinoma, then what is the answer would have been, doctor? In that case, you can do the radical excision and can be able to give the post-operative radiotherapy and all these methods. But it is already anaplastic, so palliative or symptomatic is what need to be remembered. So this basically gives you the CT scan appearance in a 75-year-old woman whose trachea had been infiltrated. Trachea is the small slit that you are finding here, and it is being infiltrated by this thyroid, and it also led to the development of the tracheal stenosis, which you can classically see. And in fact, of all the tumors which invade the trachea, the most common secondary tumor is the thyroid carcinoma is what need to be remembered. But generally it is papillary and follicular, which will be about 1 to 6.5% of cases will be involving the trachea, is what I want to underscore to all of you. Generally they are resectable, but anaplastic carcinoma is generally very invasive. It is not resectable, only palliation you need to do by maintaining the patency of the trachea by the surgery is what I want to underscore to all of you. Let's go to the next question. Diphtheria led to the development of vocal cord involvement. Generally, it will be transient and wait for the spontaneous recovery. You need not do any interventions. Anthraquinone polyp in a 30-year-old man. What is the modern practice, doctor? Endoscopic sinus surgery. So everything is through a palm peeping, doctor. You must be very good in looking to the hole and do the great surgeries, laparoscopy, except delivering the baby, everything can be done through an endoscope is what need to be remembered. Okay, so this gives you one of the most common endoscopic surgery. Or common reasons is recurrent sinusitis, nasal polyposis, mucoceles, optic nerve decompression, epistaxis control, foreign body removal, coronal repair. Probably if you are a good ENT surgeon, you can keep all these things on your board. We will do all these things. Because as a physician, what we will do? We can check sputum, we can detect TB, we will, if you are a pediatrician, you can see vaccines are given at this place. Please stop and vaccinate your baby is what you can keep aboard, right? So also, you can keep all these things we can do because we have one endoscope available at our place is what you can see. Let's go to the next question. This is a challenging question. Anion gap has increased in this and there are a lot of oxalate crystals with the metabolic acidosis. In both situation, osmolar gap, anion gap become increased with oxalurea with the development of even renal failure. What is this important condition, doctor? Please don't forget about ethylene glycol, methanol and the other glycols. They all lead to the development of the vomiting, lethargy and the coma is what need to be basically remembered. A high anion gap acidosis is common in all. But renal failure is much more common only in the ethylene glycol and not in the others. Optic neuritis with a visual impairment is much more common in the methanol toxicity. Commonly, some arak got contaminated with a lot of people becoming blind is the story we hear. It is all the culprit is the methanol is what need to be remembered. Now, why is it oxalate in the urine is the next question. Please remember that ethylene glycol is converted into the glycaldehyde by the alcohol dehydrogenase. Glycaldehyde by the action of the aldehyde dehydrogenase become metabolized to glycolate. Glycolates will further metabolize to form glyoxylate and oxalate. Hence, oxalurea is what you come across in the case of the ethylene glycol poisoning is what need to be remembered. This is a typical renal biopsy in a patient with the ethylene glycol where a lot of tubular dysfunction can be identified. You can see all those dilated, injured tubules which lead to the development of the renal dysfunction. Let's go to the next question. SVT management. First thing, what do you want to do, doctor? Give a good vagus maneuver. SVT will come down. Before you push the patient into the ICCU, you must know how to carry him from the emergency to the ICCU. You can also give one good vagal maneuver. Edinocine is the modern therapy. Earlier days we used to use verapamil. So edinocine has some important adverse effects, which is also a favorite question of examiner. It led to facial flushing, chest pain, shortness of breath, nausea and the giddiness. Now identifying the supraventricular tachyarrhythmias is one of the important challenging job and differentiating the SVT from VT. What are the five important differences is a favorite question of the examiner, doctor. But anyway, in this you can see the ventricular rate is nearly about 183 beats per minute and you try to concentrate on there is a QRS complex, after that there is a P wave. So the abnormality of the P wave will give you an indication. The morphology of the P wave, is it inverted or is it straight, will give an indication about the nature of the SVT. And you can see after you have given the adenosine, the high rate has come down in this given case. And sometimes, how is this achieved? What this adenosine fellow will do is, it will create certain amount of blockade and refractoriness in the AV node. All those supraventricular electrical impulses coming will be prevented from transmitting into the ventricle. So that's how the ventricular rate is brought into the control. But sometimes this adenosine fellow will do it too much and can lead to the development of a second degree AV block and patient can enter into a complete heart block. So SVT fellow can revert into a delayed PR leading to the finally second degree block leading to a complete block. So you need to be careful in titrating the adenosine dosage is what need to be remembered. So let's go to the next question. A child presents with diarrhea, peripheral circulatory shock, ringer lactate is what you have to basically do. So even you need not say, patient attendant only will say, why don't you start? So that's the reason you need to know about it. 20 ml per kg is the dosage which you need to remember in the pediatric age group. 5-year-old child is brought electrocuted and he is apneic and you are ventilating with the bag and mask and he is brought to you. What you should do, doctor? Intubate, airway, breathing, and cardiovascular management, so all these things must follow pari passu. This is a good question. Alveolar arterial oxygen gradient, how do you calculate? Very simple. Can you know about the arterial oxygen? You do an arterial blood gas analysis, ABG, you will be getting what is the PaCO2 and PaO2. Can you know what is the concentration of the oxygen in the alveolus? If you know that, you can calculate alveolar arterial oxygen gradient. The concentration of the oxygen in the alveolus depends on what? Am I breathing the room atmospheric air, or am I breathing with a certain oxygen pumping system and its flow rate is basically graded. Okay? So this patient is basically is ventilated and receiving 80% of oxygen. It is not that 23 or 24% which we normally breathe. Rather, he is breathing at 80% of oxygen. So first challenge for us is in this question to calculate what is the alveolar arterial alveolar oxygen concentration. Already they have given what is the oxygen's pressure in the artery. Simply you need to subtract the arterial oxygen from the alveolar oxygen. So for that there is a formula how to calculate the alveolar oxygen's partial pressure. The atmospheric pressure minus the pH2O, pressure of the water, into FiO2 the patient is receiving, minus the PaCO2 by 0.8. Why? Because we are calculating the partial pressure of the oxygen. Partial pressure is partial because of what? What is the other partial fellow? He is the carbon dioxide. So partial pressure of the alveolar oxygen is decided by the partial pressure of the carbon dioxide. Okay? So there is a reason apply this important principle. FiO2 is 80%. That means it is 0.8. So the atmospheric pressure minus water pressure, 760 minus 47 need to be subtracted. That gives you 713. At the same time, PaCO2 is given as what, doctor? 40. 40 divided by 0.8 will make it 50. So 0.8 into 713 is 570.4 minus 50 is equal to 520.4 is the alveolar partial pressure of the oxygen. Minus arterial oxygen is given as 100, 520.4 minus 100 is equal to 420.4. That's how D has become the answer, is what need to be remembered. Okay, let's go to the next question. Recurrent respiratory tract infections are seen if there is a pulmonary plethora or decreased pulmonary flow. Pulmonary plethora. What happens in TOF? Pulmonary atresia is there. Hence, right ventricular blood cannot pass so easily into the pulmonary circulation. So there is no pulmonary plethora. If it is not there, then there will be no recurrent respiratory tract infections. How about ASD, doctor? Atrial septal defect? All the left side blood enters into the right atrium. All the right atrial blood will go into right ventricle, will enter into the pulmonary blood. That leads to pulmonary plethora. That leads to development of the recurrent respiratory infections, which is the common presenting feature, is what need to be basically remembered. So this child's squatting episodes, you should not forget. If you take typically the chest radiograph, the pulmonary circulation will be relatively scant is what you can see. Whereas in an ASD child, typically there will be more amount of pulmonary plethora can be identified, is what I want to underscore to all of you. Now this question, how many have answered correctly, doctor, in the last entrance? You can be directly given DM endocrinology if you can answer. If you did not answer, don't worry. You are the part of the standard deviation curve. So now I like to emphasize to you some points here. In this, the parathyroid levels are high. It is 140 picograms, normally is less than 60. So definitely there is a hyperparathyroidism. I mean excess parathormone is there. Now the question is, this excess parathormone is primarily due to the problem in the parathyroid gland, or is it a secondary hyperparathyroidism, is what we need to basically understand. There is a whole story of this picture. But before we talk about all that, why can't it be Bartter's syndrome? In Bartter's syndrome, basically look at the calcium excretion, doctor. The urinary calcium excretion is reduced. In the case of the Bartter's syndrome, basically the urinary calcium will not be reduced, it will be more. So there's a reason, no chance that it can be Bartter's syndrome. Next, is it pseudo-hyperparathyroidism? What is pseudo-hyperparathyroidism? All the skeletal manifestations will be there, but no biochemical disturbances in pseudo-pseudo. So there is a reason it can't be pseudo-pseudo. Then what is left over for you? Parathyroid adenoma and mutation of calcium sensing receptor. Generally in a 6-month-old, parathyroid adenoma is very unlikely. That is the reason we consider it as mutation of the calcium sensing receptor by exclusion. Now, one two comments about each of them, let us pass through. So that tomorrow's exam, when this hyphae question comes, you must be able to answer confidently. Basically, how is the reabsorption of the sodium chloride, where does it happen? It occurs in the thick ascending limb of the loop of Henle, which accounts for about 30% of the filtered sodium load being reabsorbed. And basically reabsorption of the sodium in the ascending limb of loop of Henle's thick portion is basically driven by The low intracellular sodium concentration in the tubular cell, which will be sucking the sodium in the tubular lumen into the ascending limb of loop of Henle's intracellular portion. And who maintains such a low intracellular concentration of the sodium in the ascending limb of loop of Henle's cell? It is one important bumetanide sensitive sodium chloride potassium co-transporter that is located in the tubular cell will be pushing the sodium into the from the tubular cell into the interstitium. Always the interstitial cell will be having, tubular cell will be having a low sodium that will drive the sodium to be sucked from the tubular lumen into the tubular cell. That is the whole story. But in the patients who are having basically the problem with the Bartter syndrome will be having a problem with this sodium potassium 2 chloride fellow. Because of that, what happens is the sodium reabsorption which occurs in the ascending limb of loop of Henle cannot occur properly. If it cannot occur properly, it will be lost into the urine. So that is the reason they lose a lot of it is what need to be remembered. So if you look at a patient who is having the Bartter syndrome, he'll be having hypokalemia, hypochloremia, metabolic alkalosis, and generally a very severe hypokalemia will be there. They'll also be having hypomagnesemia, and they'll be having hyperuricemia. In spite of all that, the BP remains normal and the renin and aldosterone levels are basically elevated, but BP remains normal is what need to be fundamentally remembered. Now the question is, we are talking about sodium potassium 2 chloride pump. If it is not functioning, what happens? Sodium potassium chloride cannot be well reabsorbed in the ascending limb of loop of Henle. So they are lost into the urine. If they are lost into the urine, that leads to development of hypokalemia, it leads to development of the hypochloremia, and also it leads to development of the metabolic alkalosis. Why metabolic alkalosis? That means he is also losing a lot of acid into the urine. So why this acid in the urine, losing H+ ion into the urine is related to the sodium potassium 2 chloride? That has got a different story which you need to attend the physiology session. So because it takes a little longer, which is not permissible in a session like this. So finally remember, doctor, Liddell syndrome is typically, the Bartter syndrome is typically associated with hypokalemia, hypochloremia, metabolic alkalosis is what I want to underscore to all of you. And there is another friend for the Bartter called Gittleman. In Gittleman, the ascending limb of loop of Henle is okay, but the problem is with the distal tubule. So normal amount of sodium and chloride are delivered into the distal tubule, they are not properly reabsorbed at that level. That also can lead to the similar problems is what need to be remembered. So in this given case, primary hyperparathyroidism is less likely due to parathyroid adenoma because the patient is a very small child, whereas the other story starts now. That is, why can't it be the calcium sensing receptor deficiency? Basically, the people who are having this calcium sensing receptor deficiency will be developing hypercalcemia. Why does it develop? Because normally calcium is made to be lost into the urine. That won't happen in the patients who are having a mutation with the calcium sensing receptor. Hence, they'll be having a hypocalciuric, hypercalcemic stage is what need to be remembered. There are four different manifestations of any mutation, this calcium sensing receptor. The second type of manifestation is called as the neonatal severe primary hyperparathyroidism, which will occur. Why will it occur, doctor? Basically, there is a close relation between the calcium and the phosphate and the parathormone metabolism. So that is the reason they will be developing primary hyperparathyroidism, neonatal severe form. Sometimes they also develop autosomal dominant type of hypocalcemia. So they are all basically the problem with the calcium sensing receptors, which all lead to the development of the hypercalcemia with hypocalciuria with a decreased amount of the calcium in the urine in a small child in a pediatric age group is a clue to say that it is probably the problem with the calcium sensing receptor, but not the parathyroid adenoma is what I want to underscore to all of you. Let's go to the next question. A female child has learned spoon eating with the spoon without spilling. It is very important, doctor. So please remember, drinks from a cup and sets it down with only little spilling is classically seen by the age of 2 is what I want to underscore to all of you. She points with the index finger that, Papa, you are wrong, is the story which will begin by age 2 is what need to be fundamentally remembered. And also, after watching you, she will demonstrate, she can demonstrate and draw a single line on the paper in any direction you want. So be careful nowadays. Earlier days, if the child has a mistake and ask you to bring a parent signature, they were bringing sincerely. Nowadays, children are forcing it. So, because they have seen it in MTV or ETV. Okay? Let's go to the next question. Anti-epileptics mechanism of action is one of the favorite questions of the examiner, doctor. You need to know everything about it. Let us look into the different types of the modern anti-epileptics that we are having. How do they differ? But what is the key point in this question? Uptake of the gamma is decreased. Generally, after gamma inhibitory neurotransmitter is released, it is taken up. So you don't want seizures means you want to have more GABA or less GABA? More GABA. You want to have more GABA means inhibit its reuptake. So how do you do that? By giving the tiagabin is what need to be remembered. Basically, it's a selective GABA reuptake inhibitor, and it can lead to the sedation, fatigue, giddiness, which you see with the other agents like the barbiturates and other agents. How about gabapentin? It looks like GABA. It has nothing to do with the reuptake. And let's go to, and it can also be used for the social anxiety disorders and panic where you want more inhibition. To decrease the panic, you can use the gabapentin. Progabide is basically a prodrug of the GABA. It becomes transformed into the GABA, and it's a broad spectrum anticonvulsant is what need to be remembered, because it becomes converted into GABA once it enters into the CNS is what need to be remembered. It directly acts on the GABA receptor. Vigabatrin is basically an irreversible inhibitor of this GABA's, GABA transaminase, so that the metabolism, that is the catabolism of the GABA, doesn't occur and the GABA levels will increase. So out of all this, only it is the tiagabin which will be basically the reuptake inhibitor, whereas the progabide is a mimicker and vigabatrin is basically a transaminase inhibitor inhibiting the catabolism. So everything is GABA, but closely they are different from each other. You need to be doubly sure about that important fact. Mu receptor of opioids are responsible for everything, doctor, not diuresis. Okay? All the remaining things. What is the universal adverse effect of the opioids? Constipation. Let's go to the next question. Glycopyrrolates action is not on the central anticholinergic, doctor. Typically it acts on the postganglionic parasympathetic cholinergic receptors, not centrally acting is what need to be remembered. Now heparin, it is not a weak acid, doctor. Typically the heparin will be having a pH range between 5 to 7.5. In fact, to bring its basic nature, not a basically it is included with the hydrochloric acid and given to you. Heparin hydrochloride is the way in which it is given. Let's go to the next question. Pemetrexed is a new agent which is used in the breast cancer. Basically, what is the mechanism of action? Basically, pemetrexed is an antifolate, antineoplastic agent is what need to be remembered. So it will disrupt the folate-dependent metabolic process which are essential for the cell replication is what I want to underscore to all of you. Bradycardia, can it be a problem with the succinylcholine, doctor? Definitely, that is the reason one of the important protocols is what, doctor, in the pediatric anesthesia. Try to administer the atropine prior to the succinylcholine so that you can decrease the risk of succinylcholine's ability to cause a bradycardia is what I want to underscore to all of you. Let's go to the next question. Myogenic hypothesis of the renal autoregulation of the afferent arterioles. What is the basic meaning of renal autoregulation, doctor? Please remember, whatever be the blood pressure between 80 millimeters of mercury of our mean arterial pressure up to 180 millimeters of mercury of our mean arterial pressure, the renal blood flow will not be affected. It will be continuing at the same level because of the autoregulation that is there for the renal blood flow. Now let us look into who controls this basically. The mechanism behind this autoregulation is basically by the myogenic receptors which will be regulating the degree of the afferent arteriolar vasoconstriction. So you want more amount of the blood or less amount of the blood is basically decided by the afferent arteriole, whose tone is basically controlled by the myogenic receptors which will be regulating is what need to be remembered. They basically sense the blood pressure changes because they are having some stretch receptors, and based on that they will decide whether relaxation or contraction occurs. And how do they sense changes occurring in the stretch, doctor? Because they act by opening of the calcium channels is what I want to finally underscore to all of you. This is a very favorite question. Between what blood pressure to what blood pressure the renal blood flow is auto-regulated? Between 80 millimeters of mercury to 180 millimeters of mercury is what need to be remembered. Okay? There's a reason in a patient who is in shock, because of any obstetric hemorrhage, you should see to that the blood, mean arterial pressure should not fall below 80. If it falls below 80, then the what you call perfusion to kidney automatically no more auto-regulated and acute tubular necrosis is going to happen. Let's go to the next question. Saturation chiralics typically are not exhibited by the simple diffusion. So please remember, doctor, carrier mediated transport typically, there are two examples. Facilitated diffusion, primary active transport, secondary active transport, they are all the examples of the carrier mediated transport. This is different from that of a simple diffusion. Now what are the three classical properties of any carrier mediated transport, doctor? Number one is the stereospecificity. That particular carrier which is mediating will only identify one isomer but not the other. Number two, the carrier can become saturated at a point of time beyond which it can't transport anymore. So saturation will occur. And there is a point called transport maximum which will occur. Beyond that, further transport cannot be done. So carrier mediated transporter is like catching the city bus and going. It can become full and it can't carry you anymore. Simple diffusion is like stopping a fellow and then sitting on his bike. Anyway, he is going, you are also going. So that is the simple diffusion. Okay? And competition is also another important principle, doctor. If a structurally related solute comes, the carrier will not pick you up. It will pick you up your twin brother, but not you. So this is another important difference. So if you take a plot of the typical carrier-mediated transfusion, transport of glucose, if you happen to add galactose, galactose can compete the glucose. That's how the curve becomes different is what need to be remembered. So a facilitated diffusion basically is a carrier-mediated transport is what need to be fundamentally remembered. Hence it will have the tubular maximum but not the simple diffusion. Let's go to the